Good evening, Forest Hills family. Since this is an evening of musical worship and praise, we want to begin by lifting our voices aloud to God Almighty, giving thanks to Christ and to Christ alone for what He has done for us, what He is doing, and what He will do. So, will you stand with me as we sing together In Christ Alone? In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones He came to save. Till on that cross where Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on Him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground His body lay, light of the world in darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave He arose again. And as He stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am His and He is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from His hand. Till He returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. You may be seated. All God's people said, what an appropriate response to a God that loves us than to say amen. This is true. This is right. This is just. Well, most of you all are home folk here tonight, but I know we do have a few guests here, and I'd like to say welcome to you. If you don't know who I am, I'm Chris Bridges. I'm the Minister of Music here, and we are delighted that you have came out to join us tonight, home folk and visitor alike, for our special Cool Summer Nights events that we've been having this month. Tonight, we are blessed to have Denver Bierman with us, and I'll tell you a little bit more about him and his ministry just a little bit later. But if you are a guest here with us and need to use the restrooms this evening, there are a few in the back vestibule here at the back of the auditorium and out this door to my left, all the way at the end of the hall. There are restrooms there as well, too. So make yourself at home. If you are a guest, there are some visitors' cards in the pew rack in front of you. If you will do us the honor and privilege of filling those out so that we can have a record of your visit and be able to minister to you in the days ahead, you can fill that out and you could put it in the offering baskets at the exits as you leave. We will be taking up a love offering as well tonight to help offset some of Denver's expenses for being with us here and to further his ministry. So make sure as you exit the auditorium that you give generously and out of joyful hearts. And I know that you're going to be blessed to be a part of this evening. So I do want to remind you about a couple of announcements for a few upcoming events in this next week or so ahead. I've already mentioned that this is our third in a series of five cool summer nights. We had five Sundays in August this year. And next week at 6:30, we will be back on the other end of the building for a cookout and cornhole night, as we've done. Yeah, that's right. Feel free to say woohoo or yeehaw. There, thank you for that. As we fellowship together in the fellowship hall and hopefully outside, weather permitting. You know, I was joking earlier with somebody that, you know, we should have called tonight instead of cool summer night, hot and rainy summer night. And we did have a mess of bad weather, but thankfully most of that is cleared out so we could be able to get here tonight and enjoy this event together. Now, another special event at the end of the month, on the last Sunday night, on the 29th, we have another special music concert here in the sanctuary on the 29th with my friends from Raleigh, from Trinity Baptist, the Seraph Trio. I sing with most of the folks in this group as a part of the Baptist Singers Ministry, have known them for years, and you are going to get a blessing out of them as well. It will be another love offering concert. It'll be free, another great event to invite a friend to, and we'd love to be able to connect with them through that as well. Another big event that is happening in our church's life in the next weeks ahead is our yard sale, and that is going to be that same weekend that Seraph is here, but on the 27th and 28th on Friday and Saturday. So come as a shopper or come as a helper, but no matter what, we want you to come and take part of that, because all the proceeds in that event will be going to our Operation Christmas Child boxes and those things as well too. So I have already mentioned our love offering this evening, but I wanted to make mention that Denver has some products available out the door to my right here, some records and actual records as well too. I'm not kidding you, there's actually records out there, and as well as some more modern technology as well, to be able to for you to take some of his music home with you this evening and be able to bless him in his ministry as well too. So I'm going to give him a little more of a formal introduction in a moment ahead, but I'm going to ask our youth director Kevin to come up and lead us in an opening prayer, and then we will prepare our hearts for worship.
Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for allowing us to be here tonight. We thank you for allowing us to be able to gather together and fellowship in your name. We pray that you are here with Denver tonight as he plays. We pray that your spirit continues to move in this place and touches the hearts of everyone here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We are delighted this evening to welcome Denver Bierman to lead us in a concert of praise and worship, and I'm sure he's going to tell you a little bit more about himself and his ministry, but as I have been saying over the last several weeks, you may have heard his name before, associated with a group called the Mile High Orchestra, Denver and the Mile High Orchestra, and that is probably how he is best known. This group has actually recorded about 12 different projects together. They've also been seen on the Fox reality show, The Next Great American Band, where they made it to the finale of that contest. And they have also performed in two different Olympics games as well. He is a very gifted musician, talented, and pretty darn good looking too. And but his heart is for the church, and his heart is for Jesus Christ and introducing people to him through music. And I think you're going to get a blessing out of his testimony. You're going to be inspired by his music, which is a very unique style, a mixture of jazz and swing and big band at its roots. And I think those of us that have got to listen to the rehearsals earlier this afternoon were blessed, and I know you all will be blessed as well too. So let's give a Forest Hills round of applause and welcome to Denver Bierman.
All right, y'all, put your hands together with me. Yeah. Yeah. I heard an old story about a Savior came from glory, and how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. And I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning, and then I repented of my sin and won the victory. for victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. As he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. As he plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. That's right. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, and how he made the lame to walk again, and it caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. For victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. As he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all of my love is due. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. That he's built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, and about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day we'll sing up there the song of victory. For victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. As he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me, yeah, I knew him, and all of my love is due. As he plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. I got the victory in me. Hey, I have the victory. We have the victory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We have the victory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We have the victory. We've got the victory in Jesus. Yeah.
Sorry about that. Things were becoming unglued. The stand doesn't go any higher. Give me a second. Sorry. So sorry about that. Hi, everybody. My name's Denver, and Pastor Chris, thank you so much for such a very warm welcome. I'm so grateful to be here with y'all here tonight in Wilson, North Carolina. I've had a band now for 22 years. Could we get the lights up just a little more so I can see all your cute little Carolina faces out there? I won't be able to see y'all. We're having Sunday night church. I've had a band for 22 years. It's called Denver and the Mile High Orchestra. No, we don't live in Colorado. I have never lived one day of my life in the state of Colorado. I love Colorado. I've lived for 26 years in Nashville, Tennessee. That's where my band started 22 years ago. Everybody say, yee-haw! I'm mildly shocked how well you guys have a yee-haw on this side of North Carolina. I was not expecting that. But anyways, we started at Belmont University there 22 years ago, and my name is Denver. So, I was born and raised in the state of Indiana, Hoosiers in Indiana. Do we have any transferred Hoosiers out there? All none of you. Great. They're really missing out, y'all. North Carolina is easily one of the greatest states in the United States. It's such a beautiful, beautiful state. Yeah, you can clap for that. I mean, you know, you got the ocean on one side, you got these gorgeous mountains on the other. Y'all, my state is the most boring state, okay? They're really good people, but where I grew up, on our license plates for 25 years, it said the Crossroads of America. You know why it said that? You know why you have a crossroad? That's the road you're taking to get to somewhere else. You know what I'm saying? Not the destination. And where I grew up in northern Indiana, it is like as flat as a pancake. My dad, I think within the last hour, probably just got out of the cornfield. My dad has been a corn inspector for the Indiana Crop Association for like 41 years. So I have a really weird, corny family. I come by it honestly. They gave me a weird name, like Denver, you know. The apples have not fallen too far from the crazy, corny tree. I have two beautiful children back in Nashville, Tennessee, where I live. I have a son who's 16. He's almost as tall as me now. My son's name is Boston, okay? What are you laughing at out there? That's my kid's name. I wouldn't laugh at your kid's name. That's not very nice. Come on. I have a little girl who's not so little anymore. She's 13. I think she's going on 21 is kind of how it feels. She is quite amazing. My daughter's name is London. So no joke. And we have a Denver, we have a Boston, we have a London. And my wife, a couple of you are really curious, right? Well, my wife's name is Amy. So thank God somebody turned out normal, right? Yeehaw from Nashville. Is everybody ready to have a wonderful time celebrating the love of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ? I know I am. Now, I was born and raised in church my whole life. I'm grateful to my parents. I guess they knew how much I was going to need some church along the way. But how many of you guys grew up singing songs like I did, like Jesus Loves Me and This Little Light of Mine and He's Got the Whole World? Four of you are awake tonight. This is great. I love some of these songs we grew up singing, you know, in Sunday school as little kids. And so I've been trying to bring back some of these songs a little bigger than ever with our little big band sound of the Mile High Orchestra. So if you don't have the words to any of these next couple songs in this little medley, feel free to clap your hands, sing along. This is called the Sunday School Swing. All right, y'all, put your hands together. Let me do like this. I promise we're not going to clap very many songs tonight. We're going to start off with B-I-B-L-E. That's the book for me. Here we go. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. I've been waiting all week long for Sunday to come and we can sing our song, have a little church, and do our thing. Everybody's rocking to the Sunday School Swing. All right, everybody, can you snap your fingers with me tonight? We're going to get real cool at Forest Hills Baptist Church. This one goes like this. Here we go. Charge upon the battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Charge upon the battle of Jericho, and the walls came a-tumbling down. Charge upon the battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Charge upon the battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling, tumbling down. I've been waiting all week along the Sunday to come and we can sing our song, have a little church and do our thing. Everybody's rocking to the Sunday's gonna swing. All right, everybody, can you make this hand motion with your hands and your arms tonight? Some of you can do it, but we're gonna do it right here, right now. Here we go. He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 Come on. He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 Now everybody get your fingers ready. We're going to put them up in the sky like this. Here we go. This little light of mine, oh, why don't let it shine? This little light of mine, oh, why am I gonna let it shine? This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. 'Cause I've been waiting all week long, the Sunday to come, we'll sing our song, have a little church,
do I fare? Everybody's rocking to the Sunday school swing. I've been waiting all week long for Sunday to come and we'll sing our song. Have a little church and do our thing. Everybody's rocking to the Sunday school swing. Woo! Ooh, the Sunday school swing. Jesus loves me, this I know, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. I'm telling you what, Pastor Chris, I have the best seat in the house tonight because I get to be up here and I get to see all your glorious Sunday school smiles out there. And I love songs where we have a little bit of like audience, you know, interaction, a little bit of audience participation, because I get to see each and every one of you, like your individual personality. It's like you blossom, you know, before my very eyes a little bit, you know, like in that last song. And I'm kind of like in the middle of them, like, nah, everybody get your fingers ready, right? And there were a couple of you, especially on this side of the room near the back, that had maybe one too many cups of coffee for a Sunday afternoon. A couple of you were all in, and you were kind of like, oh, this little light of mine. You know, you're singing and swinging, you know? And then there's a few of you that are just a little bit on the fence, you know, tonight. You're like, I know it's August, and, you know, we have these special events, you know, every Sunday night in August. And Pastor Chris even got Facebook ads to try to get people to come out here, you know. And the music sounds kind of nice, but if I'm really honest, that dude in that weird short sleeve blue shirt is just a little too happy for me. You know, you're not sure about all this quite yet, right? So you're just a little bit more on the fence. You're like, this little light of mine, I'm not gonna do it too much, right? And then there's some of you, and you know who you are. Because your wife is secretly nudging in the pew right next to you right now. Some of you are like, I'm way too cool for Sunday school. I'm not putting my finger up in the air. But I absolutely love it. I mean, all I can really say to all of us is thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for participating or for not participating. It is wildly entertaining for me. And so I just want to say thanks very much. Now, I was born and raised in church my whole life. I kind of mentioned that to you. And I grew up in a very traditional church that might really shock a lot of you. But I grew up in a church not near as large as this one, but very reminiscent. Because we would come into the sanctuary every single week growing up, and we would come and sit in pews. And I tell you, I love that y'all have pews here. You have no idea how many children around the United States over the last 20 years I've had to try to explain what a pew is. Because they've never seen one before, right? And we would come in and we would have a piano on one side of the sanctuary, and we'd have a drum set, I mean, we'd have an organ on the other side of the sanctuary, right? Pastor Chris gets it. He was laughing about that. And what we would do is we'd sit down, and there would be these books in the pews in front of us, right? And what are those books called? They're called the hymnals. And so every single Sunday morning in church, we'd stand up and we'd open up those books, number 342, Greatest Life Faithfulness, right? And we would stand up and we would sing the first and the second and the fourth verse to every single hymn known to man. Did anybody else grow up that way just like me? I mean, whatever happened to the poor third verse, you know? I don't know any of the third verses in any of these songs. And then it blew my mind because I go to some other denominations and found out they got 6 and 7 verses in there, y'all. That's scary stuff. But all that to say, I love some of these songs that have such timeless truth about our faith in Jesus Christ. Some of these songs we've been singing literally for hundreds of years. And I think we'll be singing them for hundreds more. Why? Because they're built on truth. Because truth doesn't change. Just like the sun rises and falls every single day, it's one of the truths of this world we live in. God's truth does not change. And so I love that we have some of these songs that we can sing. And so I celebrate them. And I know that, you know, I kind of sing them maybe a little bit differently than we grew up with the organ. I totally appreciate it. And I love the organ. Believe me, I do. But I want to be able to sing these songs. And so this next song I'm going to sing, if you know any of the words, feel free to sing along. I think this might be possibly the most popular hymn here in the United States. Actually, it might possibly be the most popular hymn in the entire world. In almost every country I've been in, I've heard people singing this song in their own languages. So feel free to sing along with me as we sing about God's unfailing love and His truly amazing grace.
Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour that I first believed. Amazing grace, amazing grace, You saved a wretch like me, Lord. And amazing grace, I was blind, but now I see. Oh, thank you, God. Amazing grace, we've been set free. Oh, hallelujah, amazing grace. When we've been there for 10,000 years, bright shine. Son, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun, than when we first begun. Like me, Lord, amazing grace. I was blind, but now I see. Oh, thank you, God. Amazing grace, we've been set free. Oh, yes, we have. Oh, hallelujah, amazing grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Would you praise God with me tonight? For his truly amazing grace. You know, the older I get in my life, the more powerfully those words begin to resonate in my own heart, in my own mind. Seems like the older I get, the more I realize just how truly desperate I am. The song isn't called Mediocre Grace, is it? Or just kinda grace, is it? No, I had a conversation with my son earlier this week. He went to church camp this summer, and he's a young man living in some, these are really weird days for all of us to be living in, I'm not gonna lie. But to be 16 and in a sophomore in high school, in the midst of lots of different things that are swirling around in our society, in our culture, in our world, Boston went to church camp earlier this summer, and I'm not trying to, he doesn't even know I'm saying any of this, so hopefully he's not watching, but he felt led to possibly, that God might be calling him into possible ministry. And he has a passion to try to live a life that would be pleasing to God, to reading his word and to following Christ with everything he's got. And it's caused a lot of anxiety. And we might say, why? I mean, that's a good ambition. Sure, but how does that work out for us? How does it work out for us when we have a holy, perfect God that, like, we're chasing after his holiness and his righteousness and his goodness? It caused a lot of anxiety for Boston because, gosh, Dad, I don't know if I can do it. Maybe it's this thought here, or maybe it's this word I do say, or maybe it's the words that I don't say. Like, literally feeling the weight of humanity. The weight of our own sin. The weight of not ever really being able to do it perfectly, right? For the wages of sin is death. But there's a gift, isn't there? But the gift of God is eternal life. And I had to sit down with him and say, buddy, Jesus, when he's talking to a wonderful rabbi, a very smart, scholarly man about the ways of God in the Old Testament, he says, I did not come here, Nicodemus, to condemn the world. I came to save it, to save us from what we cannot save ourselves from. And so as Boston was going to sleep that night, on Tuesday night of this week, I'm literally praying over Romans chapter 8 over him as he's falling asleep. That nothing can separate us from the love that is in Christ Jesus. Not death, not life, not angels, not demons, all kinds of things. And even the writer at the very end says, or anything else in all of creation, just in case I miss something along the way, can separate us from the love that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's an amazing grace. That is an amazing grace. And I've sung that song well over 1,000 times. Literally over 1,000 times. I might be able to sing it backwards to you. Maybe I can sing it in my sleep if I'm lucky. And I've had seasons of my life where that little song is exactly what it is. Just a little song I know. Right. A little song I've heard my whole life. But the truth that God's grace is amazing. The truth that his love is unfailing. There's no greater truth, y'all. Not for me. Not for us. For God so loved. Right? The most famous verse in the whole Bible. First four words. For God so loved. Not for God so tolerated. Not for God so put up with, or for God so kind of liked when they behave. For God so loved. And I can remember hearing wonderful worship pastors like Pastor Chris growing up in church, and wonderful pastors speaking the word of God, preaching with the authority and the truth of God in them. And I would sit where you sit, and I would hear these folks, and I would think to myself, wow, isn't it amazing the purpose that God has for those people? I would think to myself, man, isn't it amazing the hope and the truth that God has for those people? And I would have never ever said it in a Sunday school class, or I wouldn't have ever admitted to another soul on the planet, right? I had my nice little Sunday school smile on. But I would actually think to myself, wow, isn't it amazing the love that God has for those people? And then I'd get up out of my seat, and I would go back through the double doors of my church to what I thought was my very mundane, mediocre, meaningless life. Because the truth was, I didn't think God could ever love somebody like me. Someone who has sinned so much. Someone who has failed so much. I don't know what you're going through in life tonight. I don't know what hopes and dreams you have for your life, for your family, maybe an occupation, or for even the wonderful ministry that's happening right here at Forest Hills. I don't know what fears and pain you're carrying with you tonight. The kinds of things you wouldn't utter to another soul on the planet, even maybe your own family. The kinds of things that sometimes when you lay your head on the pillow and they're like questions that are just like a broken record in your mind, night after night, they keep you up at night and they don't ever seem to have answers. I know you have these things. I know I have these things. Why? Because this is life. And sometimes life is really, really hard. Jesus, he told us. He literally said, in this world, you will have trouble. He didn't say maybe. He didn't say, oh, you know, it's, yeah. No, in this world, you will have trouble. And I've read those words, and I've prayed over those words. I've literally wept over those words. But I want to remind you and me tonight this, that verse doesn't end there, does it? In this world, you will have trouble. But Jesus says, but take heart. Be reminded tonight, Wilson, North Carolina, for I have overcome the world. And we just talked about how he overcame, that Almighty God himself came down to earth and came as a man, as a human like us, and all of our issues and all of our stuff, born in a barn around a bunch of animals a little over 2,000 years ago. He grows up as a child. He begins to teach us what it means to truly live, to teach us what it means to truly love. He does miracles that literally God, only God could do. And then he gets followers, begin to follow him around as he's trying to teach them about these timeless truths of God that somehow we've lost along the way. And then he reveals who he truly is. He says, I'm the Son of God. And then he's betrayed by one of his closest friends. For any of you that have ever experienced the incredible pain of betrayal, your God knows exactly how you feel. He's rounded up and he's ridiculed, he is questioned, he's accused of lies, he is mocked. He is brutally, brutally tortured. And if that wasn't enough, they parade him around the city for everyone to see, putting his death sentence on his own back. And then they hang him on that cross, and he dies. And just so often, as it always seems, it finally looks like love has failed. But that's not the end of the story, is it? Because on the third day, and I think God in his godness waited until the third day. He could have come back to life whenever he wanted to, but I think God waited for a third day because he knew how many first and second days I was going to have. How many first and second days have you had when hope was lost? When the fear was too overwhelming, when the pain was too much, when it looked like death truly had won. But on the third day, Jesus Christ rose from the dead to conquer death and to conquer our sin, to prove to us that he is exactly who he says he is. And he did not go to that cross out of a moral obligation to you. He did not go to that cross out of religious duty. He went to that cross out of his indescribable and unfailing love for you. For God so loves you, ma'am. For God so loves you, good sir. Not just the person sitting next to you, but you. I wrote a very simple song about the unfailing love of God. And I hope it can encourage you tonight. That no matter where you're at in life, no matter what kind of season you're in, that there's unfailing love for you. That it's not being held back, that it's not absent, that it's conditional. No. There is unfailing love for you. It is the only love that will never fail you on planet Earth or anywhere else. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you're from. It doesn't even matter what you have done in your life. Jesus Christ loves you just the same. He knows your name.
The sunshine hits your face, he's blowing you kisses from heaven. When you smell the sweet scent of rain, new life is beginning again. My God knows how you live, who you love, and where you put your pretty little head down to sleep at night. He's better than a best friend, faithful beyond the ends of time. So don't you be dismayed, you're not alone. Today, he knows your name, he sees you smile, he feels the pain from all those empty tears you've cried. He knows you, he wants you, he loves you like nobody loves you. He knows your name, he's dreaming your plans, he's holding your heart right in his hands. Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, or what you've done, he loves you just the same. And he knows your name. He knows, he knows. He knows your name. Yeah, yeah. Did you know that you make his day just because of who you are? And you bring a smile to his face, cause you are the joy of his heart. I know you carry pain, guilt, and shame. It's never picture perfect, but it's worth it when God's in your life. You might feel ordinary, but you're extraordinary in his eyes. So don't you be dismayed, your life matters today. He knows your name, he sees you smile, he feels the pain from all those endless tears you've cried. And he knows you, he wants you, he loves you like nobody loves you. He knows your name, he's dreaming your plans, he's holding your heart right in his hands. Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, or what you've done, he loves you just the same. Cause he knows your name. When life's unbelievable, it's so inconceivable, everything, anything that my God can do, nothing's impossible, he's gonna see you through. Yes, he knows your name, he sees you smile, he feels the pain from all those empty tears you cried. He loves you, he loves you like nobody loves you. He knows your name, he's dreaming your plans, he's holding your heart right in his hands. Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, or what you've done, he loves you just the same. Yeah, he knows your name, he knows, he knows, he knows your name. The fingerprints upon your hand, those hairs on your head, he knows, he knows. He knows, He knows, He knows your name. Oh, how He loves you and me. Sing with me if you know it. Oh, how He loves you and me. Because He gave His life, and what more could He give? And oh, how He loves you. And oh, how He loves me. Yes, oh, how He loves you and me. And all God's people said, amen and amen. What a wonderful and beautiful truth. A great, great reminder of encouragement for us tonight. You know, the older I get, the more grateful I am, too, to be able to come to a place like this and to be able to just stand up here and freely sing about the unfailing love of Jesus Christ. You know, I've been all over the world in the last 22 years. I've sung in the country of Turkey in the Middle East. I was there for almost 5 weeks. I've been in Eastern and Western Europe. I've been in Central and South America. I have been in Moscow, Russia. I was there for a handful of weeks, 2 to 3 weeks, doing different concerts and events there. I've been to China 3 times. I was supposed to go back to China the second week of November of 2019. And the government called, I think maybe the 20th or 22nd of September in 2019, and called and just said, you are not coming to China. They gave no explanation why. That was just very shocking. We couldn't understand that. I've gone there with a friend of mine. Do y'all call yourselves North Carolinians? Is that what you say? I'm always curious. I don't know. I mean, I call myself a Hoosier because if you're from Indiana, that's what it is. If you're a Hoosier, you're a person from Indiana, but I don't really know what a Hoosier is. It's a weird word, but it's someone from Indiana, so I just didn't know. But a fellow North Carolinian. Anyways, a good friend of mine, his name's Will Graham. He's Billy Graham's grandson. And we've been going and doing these, they're called celebrations, but they're crusades there in China. We've seen thousands of people come to know Christ in the 3 times that we've been there. And in all those places, you know, I'm grateful to have gotten to experience the people. I'm grateful to have been able to experience, you know, sometimes the food. You know, when you go to China, there is no such thing as sweet and sour chicken in China. Like, that's an American thing, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, it is. The food is very, very different there. And, you know, when I was in Turkey, I can remember on Sunday mornings when it was time to go to church, we would actually take our Bibles and we would wrap them up in brown paper bags so it looked like we were carrying our lunches with us as we walked down the street. I was in a town of about 4 million people there called Izmir for the most part, and very large city. Our church, Christian church, that met on like the 9th or 10th or 11th floor of this building, and there was probably a total of 25 of us, including the 11 Americans that were with me. Maybe 30. It's just a different place. The stories that I heard of people who had openly professed that they loved Jesus, it's incredible. How tragic some of those stories are. And so my point is this. What I'm about to say has no kind of political bearing at all. I know in a room this size, there's a trillion different opinions about the state of America and what's happening, and I'm not getting into any of that. So please give me a little bit of grace. All I'm saying is I thank God above that I have the opportunity to live in the United States of America, where I am free to sing and praise the name of Jesus Christ. This is what a beautiful place that we have here. And the freedoms that we have are not free. There's many, many people even in this own room who have sacrificed and given a lot for our freedom.
my own Grandpa Lionel. My name's Denver Lionel Bierman. I'm named after my Grandpa Lionel, and he was in World War II as a private in the Army. He enlisted. He signed up when he was 38 years old. Just still blows me away. If we had enough cups of coffee, we could be here all night sharing incredible stories, because you have these stories. We all do. Some of you are in this very room right here with us. You put your lives, you put your livelihoods, you put your families on the line to protect this beautiful country, to protect the freedoms that we cherish. And I just want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to each and every one of you that is doing your utmost or has done your utmost to try to make America a better place. And so here's what I'm going to ask. Unapologetically, I'm going to ask this. If there's any man or woman here tonight who has previously served or is currently serving in one of our armed forces, or if you are a first responder, maybe you're a policewoman, maybe you're a fireman, maybe you're someone that has done your utmost to try to make a better America a better place here even locally in Wilson or in the surrounding area, I'm going to ask each and every one of you, if you could just stand for a brief moment so we can say thank you. Thank you for your service to our country, and thank you for your service to protecting our freedoms. Would y'all please stand right now, please? Anyone here? Thank you very much. Thank you. God bless you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. May God bless you, and may God continue to bless America. Amen. These are crazy days. I know there is. There's never been a time in my lifetime where I've felt so compelled to pray, to literally pray for our country, to pray for our leaders, to pray for guidance and strength from above, for wisdom, for mercy. And some of you, you know, it's been a really tumultuous time. Some of you may not feel real blessed even in your own lives. And you see me with my mildly fashionable tie that I did get some kind of a stain on. It's got a little bit of a thing here. I did my best to try to get it out, y'all. I'm sorry. You know, and I'm like, God bless you, and God bless you. And some of you are like, Denver, I don't feel very blessed. You have no idea what I'm going through. You have no idea what's going on. I know that there's one who does. I know some of the greatest blessings in life come when, in some of our seasons of hardship, greatest hardship. I mentioned my Grandpa Lionel to you. He lived every day of his life in it's still the number one poorest county in the state of Indiana, a little town called Candleton, Indiana, right along the Ohio River. He was my mom's dad. He wasn't a beerman. His last name is Gottman. It's a German name. It means the God man. So he's the redemption, because the beerman is also a German name, which means the beer man. So there you go. Quite a mix. My Grandpa Lionel's a really neat guy. He went to school through the fourth grade. He could read. He was a deacon in his little Southern Baptist church that met about five or six blocks from the house where my mama grew up. My mom remembers until she was, I think, five or six that they still had an outhouse. They didn't have indoor plumbing yet. So just a very different kind of life than the one I've always experienced. Enlisted in the war, and he went over there at 38 as a private in the Army to Europe. And he was very diligent to write home to my grandma Irene back in Candleton. You know, I have to tell kids all the time, there were no cell phones in the 1940s, right? You couldn't just text home or call home. And in most cases, even folks' loved ones here in America couldn't necessarily write their loved ones that were overseas serving. Some of these people were always on the move, and they were in different places, going different spots, and the mail would have never gotten to them. I did learn something fascinating. In June of this year, I went to the United States Air Force Museum in Dayton, Ohio, and there were very rare instances when you could write home, or you could at home write to one of your loved ones overseas, and that was sometimes when they were rounded up as prisoners of war. The Red Cross would actually come to the German prison camps and even the Allied prison camps and take rolls, take records of who, specific names of people that are prisoners of war, and then they would find the addresses to those people, or they would get them from those prisoners themselves of where their families live back home, and then they would contact their families back home and say, this is where your loved one is, they are alive. If you need to write them or want to communicate with them, this is where they are. Now, not all the letters that were written that actually made it, you know, to the front doorsteps of those prison camps actually made it to the prisoners themselves, but on occasions they did. I actually got to read a couple of those letters. It's fascinating. But my grandpa, he would write very consistently to my grandma, and the U.S. Army Corps would send these through Europe. They would get on a boat or a plane, and then they would come overseas. Tens of thousands of letters were being delivered back in this country every single day to loved ones, praying, anxious for some kind of a word about their loved ones serving. And this happened for years. For years, my grandpa wrote my grandma every 10 to 14 or 15 days, every week and a half to 2 weeks, another letter came in the mail. For years, my grandpa wrote my grandma. One day, my grandma goes out to the mailbox. It's been about 10 days to see if there was a mail there for my grandpa, and there was no letter. And then those 10 days turned into the 15 days. But then those 15 days turned into 18 days. That turned into 21 days, 23 days, 24 days, 25, 26 days, 27. And in years, this had never happened before. My grandma Irene, being a very God-fearing woman, spent a lot of time on her knees praying on behalf of my grandpa, on behalf of his life, on behalf of their family, on behalf of their love. Prayed for his protection. She's worried sick about him. And one night during this season of no letter, she puts her head on her pillow, and my grandma has a dream. And in her dream, she sees my grandpa, and she sees him in his army uniform with his hat on his head. He was kind of a short guy. I have a couple pictures on my cell phone I can show you afterwards if you ever want to see him. But in her dream, she saw him there, standing there. He was kind of quiet. He was standing there. He was just surrounded by hundreds and hundreds of other soldiers, and that every single one of them, from their clothing to their skin, from the ground they're standing on to the sky above them, from the background behind them to the foreground in front of them, they were all completely white. They were ghostly white. They were as white as snow. My grandma kind of frantically wakes up from this dream, and she realizes, she's like, this is my sign. I've been begging and asking God to show me what's going on with Lionel. Is he okay? And this is God's way of letting me know that Lionel, that he died over there in the war with those thousands of soldiers, but that he's in heaven. That he's at peace with the Jesus that he loves. And that's what she believed. I don't really know how many exact days happened after that dream. Might have been a couple, might have been a handful more. I don't know. But what I do know, what I do know is that there was an envelope that showed up in my grandmother's mailbox that had my granddaddy's handwriting on the front of it. And inside it was like two or three letters. And on the top of the one that was on top, it said, I know you're worried sick about me, darling. I'm so sorry. Just like it is there in Indiana, it is the heart of winter here in Germany where I'm stationed. And it's been snowing and snowing and snowing literally almost every single day. My superiors say, don't even bother, they're not going to send the mail out today. So here's my collection of letters to you. As white as snow, right? Sounds like some kind of a dream or movie, doesn't it? I mean, it actually really happened that way. And some of you might be going, why in the world are you telling us this story? What does this have to do with anything? And this is what I mean. The last 2 years of life for me, I've never imagined that it would be as difficult as they've been. All kinds of things. Some days it literally feels like depression. Some days it feels like hopelessness. Some days it feels like powerlessness. It's all kinds of stuff. There's brokenness all around us in our lives. And we go through hard seasons. And we don't feel very blessed. And sometimes I need to be reminded that literally one simple little question, and that is this: what if that letter had never come in that mailbox? He spent over 2.5 years in World War II. What if? How many letters never came back, y'all? y'all would have someone else singing, or you'd be doing the barbecue this week. There wouldn't be a Denver Beerman concert tonight because I wouldn't exist. See, God was looking out for me decades before I even came onto this planet. And in the midst of my own trials and in the midst of my own struggles, sometimes I need to be reminded of some very basic and powerful truths. For each and every one of you, if you don't hear anything else that I could say or sing tonight, I hope you hear this. For any of you that are hurting, for any of you that are in fear, for any of you that are broken, I want to remind you that you are sitting upright in that pew tonight. That the author and perfecter of all life as we know it on this planet has your heart beating inside of you tonight. And I don't know what maybe some of these divine purposes are specifically for you, but thank God the author and perfecter does. And that you don't need to lean on this world to tell you what is so important about you. Because the creator of the universe wants to tell you what is so important about you and why you're here. Because God willing, tomorrow morning, the alarm clock is going to go off. Or maybe even, God willing, the day after that, or the week of that, or the month, or even years and years after that. And we get to rise up to a brand new day to experience God in His fullness. His blessings maybe are not so tangible sometimes. His blessings are the kinds of things that say that we could know the truth. And that the truth actually has the power to set us free from these things that bind us. We can take God at His word when we feel lonely, when we feel helpless, that He says, I will never, never leave you. I will never forsake you. That we get the opportunity to wake up to a new day, and I believe God at His word when He says that we could do all things through Christ who strengthens us. What blessing like that can the world offer you? In the midst of your trial and your struggle, we are blessed. We are blessed if we would just reach out and take what He so freely offers. I know it's not easy, but it's there for us for the taking. So I'm going to sing a song that you have heard a gazillion times. And no matter where you're at, I hope it's a reminder to you of who your God truly is. Of the blessings that He has abundantly poured out into you and will tomorrow morning and the day and the week and the month and year after that. But I hope it's also a reminder to who He has specifically and uniquely created you to be. And that you have a purpose here as He continues to empower you, as He continues to help you persevere in every season. So God, in these next few moments, would you just speak to us? Would you just encourage us? Would you remind us of your abundant blessings? And I humbly, humbly pray. We are a nation of human beings, God, which means we are a nation of imperfect, sinful people. And on behalf of my nation, God, I ask you for your forgiveness and mercy and grace. I ask you for your blessings to empower us to live for you, to turn to you, to seek you, Almighty God. God, may you continue, just like you've done for hundreds of years, may you continue to bless America.
If you know it, you can sing with me. God bless America, the land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans, wide with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America. wake up my home sweet home. 'Cause we need your mercy, we need your grace, we need your power, Lord, as we seek your face, oh God. We need your truth, Jesus, to set us free, yeah. We need your anointing from sea to shining sea. And every town, every city, and every child of every family, we hope in you alone. From your church to our nation, over all your creation, Lord, make your glory, make your glory, make your glory known. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans, wide with us, God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
May God bless America. Amen. I know I've talked way too much. It's time to just play some music. This next song was my great-grandpa Chance. This is his most favorite song written ever anywhere on the planet. And every time that the organ would play it, Pastor Chris, it had such a very reverent and a holy and beautiful sound to it. And then I turned around and I recorded it as a Dixieland song. So before I sing it like a Dixieland song, I want to play it for you on the trumpet tonight, very reverently, like we used to sing it and hear the organ play it in church. And it's kind of such a special song to me and my family. It's not the kind of song you try to play with one trumpet. It's definitely one you got to try to play with two. So I hope you enjoy this. Why are y'all giggling out there? This is Holy, Holy, Holy.
Trend. holy. All the saints, they adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. A cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which works and are and evermore shall be. That's right.
Fun. Thank you so much. Wasn't that kind of fun? At least I had fun. I know that's really, really loud. Sorry if it was too loud for you. But I'm a band geek. How many of y'all played like a band instrument in middle school or high school or college or something like that? Y'all are my geeks out there, y'all, my fellow band geeks. I'm glad to see some fellow geeks out there as well. All right, got a couple more songs here for you tonight. This next song is a brand new song. Well, you know what? No, I want to sing this first. I'm just going to get a couple more in. If you have to leave and I'm going too late, that's totally fine. I'm sorry. I'm loving being here. Are y'all enjoying some of the music tonight? Is this okay? Okay. I don't want to overstay my welcome. This next song is really, really great. It just says, what could wash away my sin? What could make me whole again? Absolutely nothing but the precious blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus.
Wash away my sin, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that made me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my part in this I see nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing is my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Thank you. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No, there found I know nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no, no, they're bound, I know nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Before I pass out, the last tune I'm going to do here before we close is a brand new music. I've only sung this like twice, one of which was this morning. Our band is coming out with a new album probably around the beginning of next year, 2022. But this is one of the songs that we've already recorded. And it's just been a powerful reminder for me that in the midst of all that life throws at us sometimes, I tend to put my hope in a lot of different things. You know, I hope that we do this all the time. I hope this turns out, or I hope that, you know, this person, you know, it's just all this stuff, right? But it's kind of crazy. I lost my voice last year, my singing voice. It was very badly damaged because I went 4.5 months without singing because there was no opportunities to do things in church. And in the middle of last summer, all of a sudden, like, we could socially distance a little bit outside around the 4th of July, and so I do a lot of patriotic music, and so I did 4 nights in a row outdoors of, like, 2-hour concerts of the God Bless America kind of stuff, really high and crazy, and at the end of the fourth night, my voice was real tired, but I'd sung, you know, two to three weekends a month for 21 years, and long story short, I couldn't clear my voice, and things were just kind of weird. And before I knew it, I was in a doctor's office at Vanderbilt downtown Nashville and had severe vocal bleeding on one of my vocal cords. And so he said, when you leave this room, you're not going to speak for 10 straight days, which was kind of a really, really scary thing when you have sung and spoken your entire life. And it was a 5.5 month process. And there was lots of dips and valleys and didn't know if my voice was ever actually going to recover. But in that time, the reason I'm sharing that is because in that time, I realized I was putting my hope in so many different things. And God kind of challenged me, Denver, where is your hope? Because there's really only one true hope. There's an old hymn that says it's so great. It says, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus, his blood and his righteousness. And everything is less. Everything in this world is less than the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. And so I wrote a song about this whole experience as a reminder of where our one true hope truly is. And so I'm going to close with this as an encouragement to you and me that there is hope and that he is here and his name is Jesus.
Holds me close in my lonely nights. Who's the one who never lets me go? And who speaks the truth in a world of lies? Who knows the longings of my soul? There's only one true God who saves. So I trust the name above all names. My Redeemer and my friend. Lord, my life is in your hands. My one hope is you, Jesus, only you, Jesus. Washes away my sin and shame, who restores my soul and renews my strength is you, Jesus, only you, Jesus. Every failure and fear is overcome by the power of Christ, the risen one. You are the way, you are the life, you are the truth. My one hope is you. You heal the wounds of our deepest pains. You revive my broken heart back to life. For no power or death or anything else can ever separate me from the unfailing, unchanging love of Jesus Christ. You're my shelter in every storm. When I drift away, you lead me home. Lord, you are faithful in all your ways. I trust you alone for all my days. My one hope is you, Jesus, only you, you, Jesus. Who washes away my sin and shame, who restores my soul and renews my strength is you, Jesus, only you, Jesus. Every failure and fear is overcome by the power of Christ, the risen one. You are the way, you are the life, you are the truth. My one hope is you. Oh God, I am reminded tonight that you are my way, that you are my truth, that you are my life, that you are my healing, my purpose, my redemption, my mercy, my grace. God, you are my one and only true hope, and I embrace you as my hope, Jesus. Just you, Jesus. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Lord, I know that you're my one hope, my one hope. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but I wholly lean on Jesus' name. You alone, you're my one hope, my one hope. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. I choose to say, you're my one hope, my one hope. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. For all my days, you're my one hope, my one hope. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Found in the truth, you're my one hope, my one hope. Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Only you, you're my one hope, my one hope. My one hope is you, Jesus, only you, you, Jesus. Who washes away my sin and shame, who restores my soul and renews my strength is you, Jesus, only you, Jesus. Every failure and fear is overcome by the power of Christ, the risen one. You are the way, you are the life, you are the truth. Lord, you are my way, you are my life, You are my truth, Jesus. My one hope is you. My one hope is you. My one hope, Jesus. My one hope, Jesus. My one hope is you.
In our closing moments here tonight, Denver's going to go to the piano, and we're just going to have a moment of prayer together. The altar is going to be open as well, too, if there is some business that you need to do with the Lord this evening. Will you all close your eyes and bow your heads for just a moment? You know, one of the things that impacted me in these last moments that we've shared together is about how we have this innate desire for hope. We're always looking for it. We're always looking, sadly, in the wrong places for it. We will try to put our hope in our finances. We will try to put our hope in our health. As long as I feel good, everything's okay. But when there's an illness and things start to fall apart, so our hope disappears. When our finances come crumbling around us, when we lose a job, when we are disconnected, we lose our hope again. One of the things as a church family we've been trying to do over the past year or so, you've seen it on our screen on Sunday mornings as you come into the worship center when we've been able to, you've seen the three words that say, find hope here. Doesn't mean that you can't find Jesus outside of the walls of these church. However, folks find Jesus is the best way to find Jesus. But we've been saying that because we want this place here to be a special anointed place where people can look to find that hope that this world is so missing. And you know, even our senior adult outreach ministry, our phone line is called the One Hope Line, because we want to point folks to that source of hope, the one, the only source. And you know, I know that we are mostly home folk, and many of you, if not most of you, or hopefully every one of you, have made that decision for Christ in your life, that you have acknowledged Him as your source. He is the only way, friends and church family. He is the only way. All those other things that we talked about, our health, our finances, we can't put our trust and our hope in politicians. We can't put our trust and hope in doctors. We can only put that hope in Jesus Christ. So in these moments that we're sharing tonight, we're not going to have a drawn-out invitation or anything, but I know there may be something that you need to deal with God tonight. And that may be as simple as just a word of thanks for the blessings that you have in your life. Maybe this is the blessings of health. Maybe it's a prayer that you need to whisper from the depths of your soul because there is someone that you know that does not know Christ as Savior. In these moments, cry out to Him. Cry out that name to Him. Maybe there's someone that you know that's battling a health crisis that's beyond our earthly control to solve. Whisper that prayer, that name to God Almighty in these moments because He cares for them and He cares for you. And He wants to hear from His children. I'm thankful for these moments of encouragement that we've been able to share together tonight. And I'm going to have a moment of prayer here in just a second. But before I do, we're going to have just a moment of meditation where you can whisper these prayers of thankfulness, of supplication, of petition to God. prayers for healing, prayers for anointing, prayers for the mission of this lighthouse station here on Forest Hills Road. So we're going to pause for just a moment and have a moment of silent prayer. You can come to the altar if it makes it more comfortable for you or from where you're at. But let's pray together in a few moments of meditation. Heavenly Father, hear the prayers of your people this evening as we come to you humble, asking for you to intercede in the lives of loved ones that don't know you or ones that need healing. Hear those cries of our heart that only you can hear. Work in our lives to be a source of hope for someone else and to point them to you, our ultimate source of hope. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for healing. We thank you for being able to gather together for a concert of worship tonight when this time last year that wouldn't have been an option. We thank you for your love that surrounds us each and every day with a voice that tells us in the midst of chaos that everything is going to be okay. And we thank you for that. Whisper that into the lives of those that we have prayed for. Whisper it into our own lives to give us encouragement in our walk with Christ today. And as we depart this place in the minutes and moments ahead, help us to take that light of hope with us, that beacon that we can share in this community and say that we can find hope in our lives and in their lives anew, afresh again. We thank you for Denver and his ministry. We pray that you'll bless him and encourage his spirit in these days ahead. And it is all this we ask in the name of our wonderful Savior, a Savior that knows our name, a Savior that is our hope, a Savior who is our solid rock, Jesus Christ. It is in his name that